So at the very outset, I would like to thank the organizers of OSMICON for giving me this opportunity to speak to you this morning. Yeah. Can you all hear me? I'm particularly pleased because this opportunity will allow me to speak to young friends coming from all across India. People who are representing the future generation of medical profession in our country. If you look at the healthcare situation in our country today, we have exciting opportunities and at the same time also have challenges which look daunting. We are a country of 1.2 billion people. We have the highest magnitude of every possible disease in the world. And in the years to come, we are also going to have a convergence of what we may call the diseases of the past, the neglected communicable diseases, with those which are associated with lifespan and lifestyle, such as diabetes, cardiac disease, cancer, etc. When we have the convergence of all these challenges, we have to ask ourselves the question, are we prepared to address these challenges? Let us look at some of the socio-economic determinants that influence healthcare. Of the 1.2 billion people, according to the official government estimates, 22% are below the poverty line. But I think a more interesting index came out recently from the research done by the McKinsey Global Institute. They came up with an index that is a composite of multiple factors that we all require for a minimum standard of living, which includes food, healthcare, education, energy, sanitation, safe drinking water, etc. When we apply this index to our population in the year 2012, nearly 56% of all of us in India are below that empowerment line. So that to me is the real picture. Why is it important for us to know that in the area of healthcare? That means these 56% of the people to me cannot think of allocating resources from their incomes for the provision of healthcare. On the one end, we have exciting technological progress in the country. On the other, we have these challenges of poverty plaguing us. So that is the socio-economic milieu in which, as medical professionals, we have to function. While all of us would like to do well, and there is nothing wrong in that aspiration, we also have to be cognizant of our realities, the realities of a society that we live in, a society for which we are responsible. Our responsibility increases because we got the privilege of education in this country, and we also got the additional privilege of becoming professionals in a respected profession, namely medical profession. All this adds to the burden of responsibility on our shoulders. As you look into the future, many exciting possibilities exist. Today, you have the benefit of much better understanding of the disease process compared to what we had over 40 years ago. Today, you have access to exciting biotechnological innovations. Today, you have access to biomedical engineering marvels that make your diagnosis and treatment so much easier and interventions at an early stage so much more possible. Today, you have the assistance of various forms of technology, mobile technology, information technology, design, engineering, etc. And all of them can make our job much easier, provided we know how to exploit them properly. As medical students, you have gone through a particular process of learning. And if you look around and look around the world, there are newer ways of education, newer ways of teaching, and newer ways of learning. Because a medical profession is a lifelong student. The moment you have chosen this profession and entered the portals of medical schools, you have committed yourself to a lifelong learning. Only when you make that kind of commitment can you really provide the kind of care that is required by people. Because while we have a duty, that duty also is a privilege for us. In our profession, we have the privilege of combining the two things. Several years ago, I saw a poster when I was traveling in the US, and it's a profound poster for me. It said, go out into the world and do well, but more importantly, go out into the world and do good. And here is a profession of ours where we can do well and at the same time do a lot of good. Doing well is for ourselves, doing good is for the society. So we can combine our self-interest with the larger societal good. That is the uniqueness of our profession. We keep hearing and reading all kinds of criticism about the lowered ethical and moral standards of medical profession. We get that criticism from every corner. While every one of those pieces of criticism is true, we can still be very proud. Our profession is still the most philanthropic of all the professions anywhere in the world. There is no other profession where people get free service. And paradoxically, even people don't expect free service from any other profession. So from that perspective, you belong to a very unique profession. A profession where you can do well and do good. When we talk to our own trainees at our institute, we urge them, because ours is a surgical specialty, to become 3H doctors. Doctors who use their hands, because they are surgeons, well, combine that with a thinking head to understand what the hands are really doing, and then have a heart to make you a truly medical professional, a true doctor. I believe if you look at a survey, probably a very high percentage of people who go through surgical training would have excellent hands, and a less percentage of them would have the combination of head and heart, head and hands, and perhaps even smaller percentage who have all these three. But I hope, looking at you sitting in this auditorium, the future generation of medical professionals of India, you will tilt that towards a higher percentage of 3H doctors. And I also say, if you just have the hands, you are a fair doctor. If you have the hands and head together, you become a good doctor. And if you have all the 3 H's, you become an excellent doctor. And to these three, if you add another small E called ethical practice, you become an exceptional doctor. I want each of you at this stage of your career to decide which of these categories you would like to belong to in the long run as you become medical professionals in future. You may very well say, why do I bother? I have my degree. I can go out and see a few people, make a comfortable living, the hell with the rest. Certainly, nobody can stop you from doing that. But I think we live in a country where we have this enormous responsibility of paying back to the people who paid for our education. It's not the rich alone that are paying for your education and my education. It is everybody in the country is paying their share to educate all of us. And for that reason, we have to pay them back. In India, we always say, we take care of our parents very well compared to Westerners. If that were to be true, let us look at a scenario in our family setting. When we were children, our parents take care of us because we are vulnerable. When we become adults and our parents become elderly, they become vulnerable and we tend to take care of them. In a similar vein, if you look at your own education, medical education, on whose bodies are you learning medicine? Quite often, training and education of medical professionals all across the world is on the bodies of economically underprivileged people. So if you are the type who would take care of your parents when they grow old, You should also be the type who would take care of the people who belong to the category that have given their bodies for your training. And that is the larger responsibility that we have. We can also talk of some of the exciting opportunities that you have. No longer do you have to confine yourself to the silo of clinical medicine. I know that most of you will end up as clinicians, but those of you who have the aptitude to pursue other areas of healthcare, you have unlimited opportunities. For example, the area of public health. That's where the entire prevention of disease and promotion of normal health falls into. It's a huge opportunity for many of you to get into. You have an entire area of research. It could be pure clinical research working with your own patient databases, both prospective and retrospective studies. You could participate in the development of new products through clinical trials. Or you could actually pursue basic laboratory research, either going out and learning all those skills, or you could actually collaborate with a basic scientist colleague and learn while you are on the job. It is this kind of collaboration that leads to what is called as translational research. Bench to bedside. Today, that translation has become almost instantaneous. And we can do even better in the area of translational research. Extend it one more step. Bench to bedside to the community. After all, whatever we do, if it doesn't impact the community, it has no value. A few years ago, I had the opportunity to attend the graduation ceremony of the Harvard University. The main speaker at that ceremony was J.K. Rowling, the author of Harry Potter. And the last sentence that she told the Harvard graduating class was, by getting a degree from this most famous university of the world, you are automatically becoming very powerful. And unless you use that power to help the most powerless in the world, it will have no value. And I thought it was a very powerful statement coming from her. And the same thing holds good to all of us. Whether you do clinical medicine, public health, research, all these ultimately should have to have that impact on the community and the people. Because it is the communities that support all these activities. When you look at on a larger scale, when you look at the big picture, any funding for the development of educational institutions, hospitals, research laboratories, research enterprises comes mostly from the public sector. And that means that is the money of the people that is allocated to all these areas. And if you want to get more and more of that support from the public for our work, for our evolution, for our development, we have to win their hearts. And how do we win their hearts? Only by showing an impact of our work. We all, as clinicians, focus on the care of individual patients. When it go into a public health program like a polio program, for example, it impacts millions of people. When you become a policy maker and influence policy through advocacy, you again impact societies. So in each of these areas, you have to play a role. For long, medical professionals stayed back and let others do advocacy, policy, etc. And that only led to distorted priorities and poorer results. And if we were to correct that kind of a situation in future, you all have to take the responsibility of thinking beyond clinical medicine. While practicing clinical medicine, you can combine it with one of these other areas. And one area that I make a plea to all of you is to definitely get involved with advocacy and formulation of healthcare policy for the country. And that ultimately determines your careers, the careers of future medical professionals, and how you grow, and in the larger context, the very health of our people. If you don't take that responsibility, this will again remain in the hands of those people who have no idea what they are doing. And the results would be disastrous. So as we are going towards that convergence of diseases, and those of you who are all, those who get into medical school in our country are some of the brightest of the high school products. And these bright people, all of you, should be able to contribute to an incremental improvement in our situation on the one hand, and some of you also should have to contribute to transformational improvement. Completely deviate, change the paradigm. Some of you have to contribute to that change in paradigm. And that's what future generations should look for. Don't just follow what you learn. You have to question every statement that you read in the books. You have to question every statement that you read in the journals. Nobody is God. The people who published in journals, the people who wrote textbooks, are as human as you and me. So we have to question every statement by using our intelligence that we are gifted with. And that's a job of the future generation more and more. The more combinations you look at, the better becomes your opportunities. So while we have all this, we have this wonderful medical knowledge, we can diagnose disease, we can treat disease, we can prevent disease, but there should be a constant advancement. And for that, we need entrepreneurs. Why not medical professionals as entrepreneurs? Some of you who have that aptitude should pursue that. There are many success stories around the world. People who have become physicians, who have become very successful entrepreneurs. We don't see maybe many examples in India, but certainly in the Western countries there are plenty of examples. Why not become policy makers? There's nothing wrong in some of you becoming good politicians. And I want to stress that word good. A good politician to me is one who worries only about the people they are serving, not self-serving. So some of you should become good politicians. And that will determine the future course of healthcare for the country and for the world. One other aspect that I would like to touch with you is the opportunity for global leadership. In India, we have the most problems. But we also have the most solutions to the problems in our country. Among the developing nations, we certainly are the leaders. The developing world looks up to us for that leadership. And I would urge all of you to pursue that course of leadership, that you should become global leaders. You should aspire to become global leaders in your fields of endeavor, whatever that might be. Don't just keep your sights to becoming the best locally. Try to become the best in the world. Some of you can. There are many from India who have become that. So why not you? It's just unrelentless pursuit of excellence that will take you there. And most of you sitting in this room have that capacity. It is for you to decide whether you would like to use that capacity or not. So why not some of you become global leaders in our institute? Requests from all over the world for people wanting to come for training. This is the reversal of the trend. We all went out for our advanced training. But now we have an opportunity in India where we can train the world. But I think we have to create the right kind of enabling environment to succeed in that. And those of you who have come from different parts of India, this mingling together is a huge opportunity to exchange ideas, to understand about each other, to make lifelong friends. In my own career, I have benefited from those kinds of interactions. I have made lifelong friends with many people all over the world. And those friends have helped in my maturation, in my growth, and in making me what I am today. And that's the kind of opportunity you should fully exploit in a meeting like this. Just a little while ago, a couple of young friends came to me and expressing their desire to pursue postgraduate education at the All India Institute. That's a great institute. What I learned from there was phenomenal as a postgraduate when I was there. But even more importantly, I have matured a lot. Those 4 years there was equal to my earlier 23 years. And that set my life in a particular path in those days. And why not such institutions in our own cities, in our own places? It is possible. And again, you should take leadership in making that transformation. Why not every medical college equivalent to an All India Institute? So the opportunities they have there are because of the better infrastructure, very dedicated faculty, and the systems that they have put in place many, many years ago. And the same thing is possible if you put all these three together in that matrix of success. And once that happens, there should be no problem. In that process, again, students should play a pivotal role. If students put pressure, there is always a reaction, a positive pressure, not a negative pressure. Looking for a positive outcome, and that outcome that would have a longer lasting impact. If the community and the society realizes that our actions ultimately will benefit everybody, you will have support for your actions. On the other hand, if that is perceived to be a selfish exercise, we will have no support. So these are all some of the things that we have to determine. And I'm very fond of Osler. I don't know how many of you know the name Osler. William Osler is considered to be the best physician ever born. Outstanding physician, teacher, researcher, philosopher, and writer. He worked at Johns Hopkins in the US, Oxford in the UK, professor of medicine in both places. I'm reading a relatively longer paragraph from him, and I think that summarizes, in some sense, what we are as medical professionals. To us in the medical profession, who deal with the individual and measure progress by the law of the greatest happiness to the greatest number of people, the great boon of this wonderful century is advances in science. Measure as we may do for the progress of the world, materially in the advantages of engineering, sociologically the great improvement in the conditions of life, intellectually the diffusion of education, morally in a possibility of higher standard of ethics, but there is no one measure which can compare with the decrease of physical suffering in man, woman, and child stricken by disease or accident. This is the one fact of supreme importance for all of us in the medical profession. And I would like to end by using another quote from him. We would like each of you to become busy, useful, and happy. Busy you will certainly be, as the demand is great. Useful your lives must be, as you will care for those who cannot care for themselves. And happy life shall be yours, because you have chosen a vocation which satisfies the soul. Ladies and gentlemen, young friends, thank you all so much for giving me this opportunity to share some of my views with you. I deliberately did not talk on any clinical topic. I deliberately did not talk on any research topic or public health topic, because you hear that from many others who probably will do a lot better job than I do in that respect. Thank you all so much again.